Like I've got share and it's
First, the presentation has to be opened in your, yeah, okay. Now
okay.
you are doing, yes, we can see your presentation. Thank you very much, Dr. David Bach.
Okay, thank you. So thank you very much for the invitation. I'm sorry about the few problems. We're going to talk about drug-drug interactions with new recommended antiretroviral regimens. I have a few disclosures, and that's shown on this slide. And what I'd like to go through is four topics. One is the development of antiretroviral therapy, then a little bit about comorbidities and polypharmacy. Thirdly, the challenge of antiretroviral interactions with some cases. And then fourthly, a little bit about COVID-19. So these are the areas that I'd like to discuss with you. If we go to the number one point, which is the development of antiretroviral therapy, I think when you look at where we've come from, and I'm getting older, it's always interesting historically to see where we've come from and where the issues for a drug interaction perspective arose. And they actually arose at the beginning of the advent of protease inhibitors. This is where we really got interested in drug interactions. And the Liverpool resources, which started out simply as cards with a traffic light system of red, orange, and green, those cards were the first evidence that we had that drug interactions would be an issue that we would have to face in antiretroviral therapy. And from that arose a lot of different resources on websites, which we'll talk about. And then we came into the integrase era, which is much of our discussion today, and the whole drug interaction perspective in the last 5 or 6 years has become very different. When we're looking at what has happened in the last number of years, one of the major issues has been to seek the reduction in the burden of drug for our patients, either by reducing the number of doses in the day, and we've gone from three times a day early many years ago to twice daily to once a day, reducing the number of pills. Secondly, reducing the number of drugs in a regimen. And this is one of the issues around going from three drugs to two drugs with two drug regimens. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Reducing the drug dosage, for example, I think when you look at tenofovir with TDF and TAF, in a sense, what that is to reduce the amount of tenofovir that's circulating. So reducing the drug dosage from 300 milligrams of TDF to 25 milligrams of TAF. That's one example. Reducing the number of days on antiretroviral therapy. Again, there's been interest from time to time of could we have the weekend off for dosing, 5 days on, 2 days off. An early study was done with efavirenz in the PHOTO study, and more recently, interest with dolutegravir. Can you have 5 days on, 2 days off? And then finally, increasing the dosing interval. Huge interest, of course, around long-acting preparations, implants, injectables, patches, and also even long-acting oral formulations of drugs. So we have considerable interest in all of these different modalities about reducing the drug burden. And this leads us to the fixed dose combinations that we have of reducing the number of doses. And there are a number of fixed dose combinations. We started out with efavirenz, a tripler, and now we've gone to a lot of the integrase inhibitors with dolutegravir, Triumeq, and with Bictegravir, Biktarvy. But also, we have the Genvoya preparations for elvitegravir. And we're going to talk a little bit about doravirine because we have doravirine also in a fixed dose combination. These are the three drugs in fixed dose combinations, but also we have the two drug combinations. Particularly of interest is dolutegravir 3TC with the studies done by Pedro Kahn and others from Argentina, and the interest, I think, in some countries in South America for two drug regimens. So these are the drugs where we have fixed dose combinations and a lot of interest. But one point, and I'm not going to talk a lot about two drug combinations, but just one point about a two drug combination, that this must be virologically non-inferior to a three drug regimen and must have a toxicity tolerability advantage. If we're talking about two drugs, we must be absolutely sure that it's non-inferior from an efficacy perspective, and it must have some advantage for us so that we can avoid some of the question mark issues for us in clinical practice. And it must have good patient satisfaction. So there are issues that we have to think about for two drug regimens. So in summary, for the first part of the talk, I think we'd all agree that heart efficacy is either reaching or has reached a ceiling. It's very hard to do better than 95% plus. So I think it's really hard for us to be able to do any better than what we have. Our new goals are very much to be patient-centered. We must think about the patients and having drugs which will actually suit our patient population. And there are regimens that we have available, which gives us great options. And going forward, we will have others that will give us great options. And our two drug regimens are now included in some treatment guidelines as recommended options. So in our European guidelines, the two drug regimen of dolutegravir 3TC is now in those guidelines as an alternative. That brings us to the second perspective, and that is to look a little bit about comorbidities and polypharmacy. I think there's a lot of information about comorbidities, many huge cohort studies. So I've just shown on this slide four huge cohort studies, the US NA Accord, the French DAD-AIDS, the Pan-European EuroCEDA, and the Italian GEPO study. Now, all these studies have documented comorbidities in different age groups of patients, sometimes subdividing by below 50 and above 50, sometimes looking at strata for different 10-year intervals as to what are the comorbidities in those who are 40 to 50 versus those who are 60 to 70, for example. And in the GEPO study, specifically targeting patients who are older than 65 years of age, in order to give us an understanding of the complexity of the comorbidities. And with the comorbidities, it links to polypharmacy. Thinking about comorbidities, you have a number of different factors that play into comorbidities in a patient population. The patient, the environmental factors within the construct of that patient, so the internal physiological functioning of the patient, renal function, hepatic function, cardiovascular function, and then external factors such as the lifestyle of the patient and what the patient is in terms of alcohol use, for example, or other drug use, how that may play in to thinking about comorbidities. And sometimes genetic factors are also important. Also the infection, how long has the patient been infection in the patient, and a whole host of immunological factors that can play into comorbidities, plus the therapy and the length of treatment and which agents a patient has been treated with. So all of these are important in terms of understanding comorbidities. And then polypharmacy. And showed here are a number of publications from the last year or so, large studies, smaller studies, patients who are greater than 65 years of age, patients who are greater than 50 years of age, a definition of polypharmacy being at least five non-antiretroviral drugs. So discounting the antiretroviral drugs in looking at the number of drugs, these are just the co-medications. And basically it's around 30 to 40% of patients are having greater than five non-antiretroviral drugs. And I think your own experience in your own clinics will be that you will have patients who are on many different co-medications. Just looking at two specific examples one study in the United Kingdom from a study that my own center has been involved in. And this is a study called POPPY. The blue is HIV is HIV positive patients. The orange is HIV negative subjects. And the way that the figure is constructed is, let's just look here, for example, at patients who are taking 5 to 9 medications. Those who are HIV positive, clearly many more patients are taking those drugs, and greater than 10 medications, you can see the HIV patients are taking far more medications. So this is a factor which comes through in virtually every study. The largest study to date is a Spanish study. It's a study from Madrid. It was a cross-sectional population-based study done in 2017 when all HIV-infected and HIV-uninfected individuals who picked up prescription drugs in hospital and community pharmacies in Madrid were followed for a period of 6 months. Notice the size of this study. So there were 23,000 HIV-positive subjects, 6.6 million HIV negative. And again, looking at the blue bars, this time stratified by periods of 10 years, at each time interval, apart from those who are over 75, we see a greater degree of polypharmacy. So polypharmacy greater than 5 comeds, greater in subjects who are HIV positive. And this is repeated in studies which we could amplify on. Now, is this just a theoretical construct? Is this just something which is theoretical? Well, clearly not. So here's an example of one patient that was referred to us recently. The patient was on darunavir cobicistat plus dolutegravir and was taking 28 separate co-medications. And when we looked at this, and you don't need to go through all the different drugs, there were two drugs that definitely the patient should not have been on, given they were on a boosted regimen. And one of the drugs was ranolazine, and the other drug was fluticasone. And so these drugs are contraindicated with a booster. So out of all of those drugs, looking at a prescription reconciliation, those two drugs should not have been given with a boosted regimen. And we're asked often about what is the harm caused by drug interactions? Is this an issue which is as important as a pharmacologist would say it is? And the answer, I think to some extent, is it is a very important issue. And a study from France recently looked at subjects who were greater than 65 years of age. And they followed their subjects for a period of 1 year, the year was 2016, and 9,000 in total. And they classified according to patients who did not in that year have what was regarded as a clinically significant drug-drug interaction. Those patients, 7,500. But there were 1,500 patients who had in that year of 2016 what was regarded as a clinically significant drug interaction, as and the definition was it was a red flag drug, a do not co-administer, in the Liverpool website. And the implications of having a drug which should not have been given was the cost difference between the two patient groups was over 3,000 euros. So having been given a drug which should not have been given, which was contraindicated, led to hospital costs which were over 3,000 euros for those patients. And the drugs that were implicated were all boosted regimens apart from one category. So it was boosted regimens, a boosted PI with inhaled corticosteroids. It was a boosted PI with cardiovascular drugs such as amiodarone, simvastatin, apixaban, or rivaroxaban. So these were examples of drugs which should not have been given where there was some consequence of taking the drug into the clinical situation. So it is important, and we have to think of the healthcare costs. So in summary of the second part of the talk, we're in a situation where, yes, we have patients with multimorbidity. Yes, we have patients with polypharmacy. Yes, in many situations, you have patients where there's polydoctory. That is, patients are getting drugs from different sources. And this can all lead to having to really consider drug-drug interactions, as well as medication adherence, potential prescribing cascade errors. And the implications of drug-drug interactions are that we have to think about the impact of that drug interaction on both the antiretroviral. So the antiretroviral can be a victim of an interaction. So the co-medication can cause an effect on the antiretroviral, or the antiretroviral can be a perpetrator of an interaction and be the reason why a co-med is affected by our antiretroviral drugs. And then to the third point, which is the challenge of actually understanding antiretroviral interactions, and then a few cases. So the question is, when are interactions of concern? It's an important question. When are we concerned about interactions? And the answer to that question is when co-administration leads to safety, efficacy, or tolerability issues which are greater than when the drugs are given alone. And that is what we've been really trying in the Liverpool Interaction Checker, to try to give information which will help when there are interactions, or when there are a number of co-medications that we need to know something about the potential. And we have 780 co-medications in the Interaction Checker, plus all the primary drugs and regimens. Now, we also have, and it would have been launched at the HIV Hep in America's meeting in Buenos Aires in April, which of course is now being canceled. We were launching the Spanish version of the checker. We're hoping to still launch it with our colleagues from Huesped in Buenos Aires, with Pedro Kahn. So it will be a soft launch rather than a definite launch in Buenos Aires, but it is virtually ready to go. So this is a fully integrated Spanish version of the Interaction Checker, which we hope will be of interest to colleagues in many countries in South America. So which drugs, just in summary, cause us the greatest searching for drug interactions? And the answer is, if you take all of the medications which are in the Liverpool website, categorize them by the green, which means no interaction, or the yellow, which means a potentially weak interaction but of no clinical consequence, the orange, which means that there is an interaction of clinical relevance that we might have to monitor, change the dose, or consider some other strategy, and the red, which is drugs should not be co-administered. And just a snapshot of looking at the colors on these pie charts show to us that with the boosted antiretrovirals, we only have about 50% which are green, which means 50% of all the co-meds, there is something probably that we need to look at. And that is true also for efavirenz. It is true for etravirine. But if you look at the integrase, raltegravir, dolutegravir, and bictegravir, then those drugs are drugs with a preponderance of green, and there are only relatively few interactions for us to have to consider. It doesn't mean there are none, but there are many, many less than if we were using a boosted regimen or efavirenz. And similarly for doravirine, doravirine has got relatively few drug-drug interactions and parallels pretty much dolutegravir or bictegravir in its profile, which is good news for the regimens which are more the newest regimens for us. Now, one of the things that we can do in our Liverpool database is to search for what colleagues in the world are searching for. So what are the interesting co-meds that people are searching for? And this is the data from January 2019 to December. So 1 year of looking, and there were 4 million searches in our database. And the drugs that people have been searching for are primarily, number one, the statins. So the highest search for drug globally is atorvastatin, but also appearing is rosuvastatin and simvastatin. And then we have the proton pump inhibitors, secondly. So omeprazole is the second highest drug searched for, pantoprazole, and the H2 antagonist ranitidine. And I can just go through quickly this chart showing what are people interested from their patient cohorts in looking for co-meds. And there is metformin. Here is rifampin plus amoxicillin, trimethoprim, sulfamethoxazole, isoniazid, so different antibacterial drugs. Analgesics, such as paracetamol, ibuprofen, and aspirin. And then cardiovascular drug, antihypertensive amlodipine, some CNS drugs, sertraline, and antiepileptic, valproate, and carbamazepine. So here are the top 20 drugs. Now, there are many, many others, but these are the top drugs that people search our database in terms of what maybe their patient cohorts are receiving. Now, when we're thinking about the integrase inhibitors, there are only actually three of those drugs that we should be concerned about, and that is metformin, rifampicin, and calcium supplements. So here, here, and here. And those three drugs we will just look at in a little bit more detail as we go through the next few minutes. But it's really important to note that people are searching for all of those different co-meds, but only three are relevant to raltegravir or dolutegravir or bictegravir. Certainly more for elvitegravir, but these are the primary ones. And the other thing we can do is to look at Mexico. So what are colleagues in Mexico searching our database for? And comparing the global search, the top 10 global drugs on this side, here we have the searches in Mexico. So the top drug searched for is metformin, secondly, omeprazole, thirdly, rifampicin. And then appearing in the top 10 in Mexico, but not in the top 10 globally, is valproate, clonazepam, sertraline, alcohol, trimethoprim, and the direct-acting antiviral sofosbuvir, valparaisvir. And here we have atorvastatin. So four of the drugs, as indicated, are in the global list and in Mexico, and there are some which are now appearing higher in Mexico than they are in other parts of the world. And we can break this down by Argentina or Brazil or different countries, and that may be of interest to you. So just three of the drugs as far as the integrase inhibitors are concerned. So number one, metformin. Metformin is a drug which, from a mechanistic perspective, we are interested because it is excreted through the proximal renal tubule. And it's excreted by a direct process of using transport proteins. So if we look at this blue dot, the blue dot is the metformin, and it goes through the proximal tubule into the urinary space. But dolutegravir and bictegravir can block that process, whereby metformin can't easily get through the proximal tubule, and it increases the exposure of the drug in the plasma. And so we have an increase in plasma exposure of metformin. And this increases the amount of the metformin that's circulating in the plasma. So dolutegravir can increase metformin exposure by around 80%. So that's an increase of metformin exposure about 80% when it's given with dolutegravir. With bictegravir, the increase is less. And this is a pharmacokinetic profile over 24 hours, showing in the red metformin exposure with bictegravir and metformin exposure without it, the black line. That is about a 39 to 40% increase in metformin. So it's half of what you see with dolutegravir. And if you analyze that data, that impact had no effect on lactate versus placebo. And the way that it's interpreted is that metformin may be co-administered with bictegravir without any restriction in patients with normal GFR. And the reason for that statement is that metformin exposure also increases as the GFR declines, as you have a degree of renal impairment. So you have two things that can increase metformin. So we have to think about the GFR of the patient as well as the impact of the integrase inhibitor on metformin exposure. Now, sometimes you get a little bit confused because people interpret the data differently and give us different guidelines. So for example, with Triumeq, in the United States prescribing information, it states, limit the total daily dose of metformin to 1,000 milligrams and monitor blood glucose. In the European SmPC, it says dose adjustment of metformin should be considered when starting and stopping dolutegravir, but it doesn't give that ceiling of 1,000 milligrams, although many people would go along and say 1,000 milligrams in the presence of dolutegravir certainly should be what we the maximum that we should aim for. So sometimes you get different perspectives. And then we get a lot of different case reports appearing, and people have their own ideas about the relevance of this interaction. So here's a paper about dolutegravir and metformin, a clinically relevant or just a pharmacokinetic interaction. Is this just something the pharmacologist is telling us, or is this actually relevant in my patient? And here's another one. How relevant is the interaction between dolutegravir and metformin in real life? The conclusion from those two papers was, yes, it's a highly significant PK interaction, but clinically it may be not as important as some people are saying, because we don't see hypoglycemia, we don't see lactic acidosis in those patients. And then you get other people saying, well, we've seen hyperlactatemia. So it is a clinically relevant interaction. And we suggest that physicians certainly remain vigilant and limit the total daily dose of metformin. So sometimes you get these different ideas coming through in the literature, and we have to try to synthesize that. And we aim to synthesize that information and try to give a clear perspective in our website. But it's not always easy when you have differences of opinion. The second interaction following metformin I want to mention is rifampicin, because with integrase inhibitors, rifampicin is an important interaction. And shown here are rifampicin, rifabutin, and rifapentin with some of the key antiretrovirals. And I want you to note that there's a lot of red, do not co-administer. And there's the orange, which means we have to do something. So I want to highlight dolutegravir and bictegravir. Now, dolutegravir is an orange with rifampicin. Bictegravir is a red with rifampicin. So why have we come to that conclusion? And the answer is we have the clinical studies which have driven our recommendation as far as rifampicin is concerned. So the Inspiring study was a study which has been published just recently in 2020, in February 2020, and Inspiring looked in summary at dolutegravir 50 milligrams BID during and 2 weeks after rifampicin, and then switching to 50 milligrams once daily. So the basis of that is that you get a decrease in dolutegravir exposure with rifampin. So to overcome that, we give an extra dolutegravir 50 milligrams. And the clinical data, as far as looking at viral load was concerned, was that there was no substantive difference between a Favarin's and the dolutegravir arm. And in the table, the PK data suggested that we had adequate exposure of dolutegravir when it was given with rifampicin. So we can overcome the interaction with rifampicin by giving an extra dolutegravir. Now, programmatically, that isn't always a straightforward thing to do, giving an extra dolutegravir, but that is how to overcome that interaction. However, there's a study which has been published recently from Botswana looking at clinical and virological outcomes of TB-HIV co-infected patients. And in some of those patients, they did not increase dolutegravir to give it BID. They just gave 50 milligrams QD. And they said in that paper, a small number of patients had a high rate of viral load suppression. So irrespective of not increasing the dolutegravir, in some patients they did, across all strata, they found a high rate of viral load suppression. At present, that is not sufficient to change the recommendation. But it may be interesting to see how that plays out in the future. And then with the pharmacokinetics of bictegravir with rifampin, the magnitude of the interaction in an open label, multiple dose phase one study of bictegravir PK in healthy volunteers who received BIC QD and BIC BID plus rifampicin was that you did not overcome the interaction. You still had about an 80% reduction in bictegravir exposure, even by doubling the dose. So this combination is not recommended. And this is where we get the red box from in our database. And then thirdly, before we just look at a couple of cases, is the relevance of acid reducing agents with integrase inhibitors. Because this is highly searched for, as we saw, and omeprazole was one of the drugs that came out right at the top of searches. Very important to note that when we're looking at raltegravir or dolutegravir or bictegravir, everything is green. With omeprazole, pantoprazole, there is no effect of acid-reducing agents on these drugs. Similarly for doravirine, no effect of the proton pump inhibitors on these particular drugs. The issue is around atazanavir and ropivirine, where these drugs are acid sensitive in terms of their absorption. Similarly for ranitidine or one of the H2 receptor antagonists. Where the issue for the integrase inhibitors comes is with the antacids, which are cations, which can be given relatively often over the counter, such as aluminium, magnesium, calcium, and even iron supplements and things like that, any cation. And these can lower the exposure of the integrase inhibitors because they bind to the cation, the integrase inhibitor, and therefore you reduce the exposure of the drug. Most of them are orange flags that we have to do something about, apart from raltegravir, where there are many red flags with the acid-reducing agents because of the magnitude of the interaction. The only one that's not red is calcium, which is with the BID regimen that you can overcome with the BID and calcium. So in summary, all the integrase inhibitors are affected by cation-containing antacids, but there are a lot of different recommendations, and really, it has to be looked at, the recommendation, broadly, as long as you separate, that is the key thing, to separate the antacid from the integrase inhibitor. That is key to overcoming the interaction. But there are other specific recommendations relative to aluminium, magnesium, or calcium, and with or without food, that can alter the individual recommendation. So just the final one that I want to give here is if you look at Triumeq, and look at Triumeq in the SMPC, which is the European label, with aluminium magnesium, it's take well separated in time from Triumeq, a minimum of 2 hours after or 6 hours before. That is true also for calcium. But if you look at the prescribing information, they actually subtly change it around. They say take Triumeq 2 hours before, which is slightly different to the wording in the SMPC. And also they add with calcium, Triumeq and supplements can be taken together with food, which is not in the European label. So food can boost the exposure of dolutegravir and in many people's eyes, that is adequate and can be taken at the same time as the supplement. I'm going to miss out the statins. So the key advice for clinicians in relation to integrase inhibitors is that the not boosted integrase inhibitors have massively changed the landscape of drug interactions. There really are relatively few clinically relevant interactions, but it is necessary to use a drug interaction checker just to make sure of a specific drug as to whether this might be an issue that we have to consider. And really, I just urge that from time to time, we do this medication reviews and check for the inappropriate use of drugs and ask the patients those things that they may be taking. And I know that often they can be taking things which are herbals and other so-called medications or medications they get from different sources. Finally, just one issue about doravirine. We summarized before that with doravirine, there were many less drugs that we would have to consider for interactions. And I've just highlighted those that are red, contraindicated in most of the labels and in our database. And you can see here that, again, we're talking about the anti-TB drugs. We're talking about the anti-epileptic drugs and St. John's wort, for example, and a TAF for HBV because of the formulation. So here we have a number of different drugs which are of concern for doravirine. So let's just go to a couple of cases and just quickly go through the cases, and then you can feed back any points that you would like clearly around specific issues. So here we've got a 42-year-old MSM who's diagnosed HIV positive 3 years ago. He's stable on darunavir, cobicistat, and FTC TAF. His adherence is excellent. No HIV resistance on baseline genotype. 4 months ago, he had an HIV less than 40 copies, and his CD4 count is good, but he's an active gymnast or weightlifter. Not at the present time, of course, with COVID, I guess, unless he's got the weights in his own home. But he recently saw a specialist and has been receiving steroid injections for shoulder problems. And that was unknown to the HIV provider. He's on other current medications such as lisinopril, hydrochlorothiazide for hypertension. He's taking some over-the-counter supplements, but these don't seem to be a problem. But at his current visit, he had a notable weight gain in the past 4 months of several kilos. His blood pressure is not well controlled, and he reports being excessively irritable, has difficulty concentrating, has headaches and dizziness. So there are some issues there that really have to be addressed. And immediately, I guess, we're thinking, what about these steroid injections with a boosted regimen? And that is absolutely right. There are many case reports of people taking injections such as triamcinolone with a boosted regimen, be it ritonavir, and these are case reports with ritonavir, of iatrogenic Cushing syndrome, and also cobicistat, so steroid-induced effects in a person living with HIV caused by a drug-drug interaction between cobicistat and triamcinolone. And if we just think of what this patient has got in relation to what we know about signs and symptoms of Cushing, well, this patient clearly had weight gain. He was reporting headaches, depression, anxiety. He was, and we're seeing an increase in blood pressure. So there's a lot of things going on which really indicate to us that there's an issue between the steroid and this boosted regimen that the patient is on. And just to remind us that steroids are a problem, whichever modality, whichever route of administration, apart from beclomethasone, which is a green, and hydrocortisone topical, everything else has an issue with protease inhibitors or anything boosted. So this patient was on a boosted protease inhibitor, and there's issues which are contraindications and dose modifications which have to be considered when we have a boosted regimen. However, when we think of those same corticosteroids with dolutegravir or with raltegravir or bictegravir, virtually everything is green. There aren't those problems with the integrase inhibitors. There's just a couple of considerations with bictegravir around dexamethasone and betamethasone. So non-boosted gives us a real greater freedom as far as drug interactions are concerned. So in this patient, this was his initial regimen, so we have options to extend and to go forward. And probably the best way will be to switch off the boosted regimen to an unboosted regimen to avoid the problems of steroid injections. Could be bictegravir, bictegravir-taf, dolutegravir-FTC-TAF, or dolutegravir-abacavir-3TC, or doravirine-3TC-TDF. So the different options are there for us, and those symptoms should gradually resolve. And the second case is one of a complicated multiple comorbidities patient. And this is a patient who's recently been diagnosed at age 62, and his viral load is 105,000. CD4 is 520, and he's got an EGFR, which is 50. So one has to have that in the back of the mind, that his EGFR may be declining, multiple comorbidities, which are at this present time well controlled, but he's hypertensive, atrial fibrillation, he's diabetic, he's got reflux disease. And so there's a lot of things going on with a lot of different co-meds, amlodipine, atorvastatin, the NOAC, dabigatran, digoxin, the gliptin, sitagliptin, omeprazole, quetiapine. And the decision is to start the patient on an integrase-based regimen. So what would we go for? Well, if you actually look at the database, then all of those drugs, bar none, do not interact with either bictegravir or dolutegravir or raltegravir. So even though it's a complex patient, there are no issues as far as drug-drug interactions, apart from the boosted integrase, L-dolutegravir consistent, where we see a couple of reds and we see some ambers, which we would have to manage. So we would have to think about what we do with dabigatran if we have a boosted regimen, what we do with quetiapine, etc. But the non-boosted, there are no interaction issues. So again, with this patient, because there are no interactions, we would have to think about the patient's declining renal function and his cardiovascular risk. And so not only is the drug interaction consideration, but it's renal function, cardiovascular risk, and then maybe the recommendation would be to go for a bictegravir or a dolutegravir FTAF, probably not dolutegravir abacavir 3TC or a raltegravir regimen. So here we have to think about different issues. Now, finally, in just 2 or 3 minutes, and I'm sorry, I was a couple of minutes late starting, just a couple of issues around COVID-19. Now, I think you all know that with COVID-19, there are no approved drugs, but there's a lot of drugs being discussed. And I think there have been 27,000 publications on COVID in the last 6 weeks. So it's a lot of literature on COVID. And the possible role of remdesivir from the Gilead drug that was used in Ebola, the IL-6 receptor blocker, tocilizumab, a lot of discussion around chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, sometimes with azithromycin, protease inhibitors, so studies ongoing with darunavir, and issues around lopinavir, which in this particular slide, which came from AASLD last week, they put no role for lopinavir ritonavir, but it's in a WHO solidarity study. So we'll know in a few months as to whether lopinavir does have a role. So there's a lot of drugs being studied, also favipiravir here as well. Now we tried to develop straight away in response some prescribing resources for COVID-19 drug interactions. And so we have at the moment just PDF charts, and the fully integrated interactive website will be available in about 4 weeks. And we've tried to develop this as quickly as possible. So there are many, many charts such as this. This is interaction with the experimental COVID-19 therapies, adazanavir, caletra, remdesivir, favipiravir, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, etc. And here we're showing antibacterials and listed the different drugs and some of the issues that will have to be considered, particularly here around the drugs having a QT and a PR prolongation issue. So there may be some synergy or some problems if you have two drugs with a QT prolongation or cardiovascular risk, and ECG monitoring being advised, but that's not always easy in different settings. So we have these charts, and there are multiple charts that can be downloaded. And we also have other charts such as administration in cases of swallowing difficulties. So there's been issues, we've been asked considerable number of questions about Kaletra in patients who may be having the drug by nasogastric tube, if that is in using the drug in some settings, because in crushing of the lopinavir is shown a decrease in the exposure, what do we do? Well, we're giving some advice at the moment as to consider at least the doubling of lopinavir ritonavir to 800, 200. So all of these issues twice daily. So all of these issues we are trying to address, and renal impairment, hepatic impairment, and other such issues. And to date, until last week, we'd had 63,000 users had started using this website, and it's only been up and running for about 3 weeks. So in Spain, because of their cases, we have a lot of users in Spain, followed by the United States. So that's basically what I wanted to discuss with you. I'm sorry, it's been a little bit longer than 40 minutes, like 44 or 45 minutes. It's very much part of a team, and I'm happy to have some discussion, and I hope there was something of interest there for those who are listening. Thank you so much. Is that okay?
Yes, thank you very much, David. We have some questions from Oaxaca, please.
Hello.
Yes, hello. Well, we have the first question. I would like to ask you something. In an integrated era, what interaction do you consider will be the most problematic for aging people?
For aging people in the integrase era, for the non-boosted integrase therapies, there really are very few interactions other than the ones that I highlighted, which clearly, you know, for the diabetic patient on metformin, that's one that we have to think about at least. It's probably the over-the-counter issue of getting these antacids that many patients may be taking, and making sure that we manage or tell the patients, keep reinforcing to the patient that they need to separate their over-the-counter antacids from the integrase inhibitor, just to ensure that they do that. And then I described the impact, for example, of rifampicin as an enzyme inducer. The other enzyme inducers, the key enzyme inducers, are the anti-epileptic drugs. And I realized that sometimes there is no alternative to giving a specific anti-epileptic drug, because controlling epilepsy is absolutely critical. And so we have to think then to manage those patients who are on an anti-epileptic drug, which is an enzyme inducer, as well as being something that could affect our integrase inhibitors. So that probably is the other group that we need to think about. But overall, that there are not very many interactions, which is very different from the boosted drugs that we've used and still use, and efavirenz, for example. So it is good news that interactions are very much less.
Okay, thank you very much. We have waiting a question from Oaxaca. Meanwhile, we see now islatravir and fostemsavir. Yes. What could you tell us about possible future interaction with these drugs?
So fostemsavir will, I think, be launched in around May. We are just finalizing our database with the interactions with fostemsavir, and it will go live in May, we have been asked by Viv, not at this stage to talk about Fostemsavir interactions because it's not yet approved and they haven't got the final documentation as far as the FDA and the European Licensing Agency is concerned. So I'd rather come back to that question maybe in some other time, but I think there will be many less drug interactions than some of the other drugs. Again, I think we're going to parallel more closely towards the integrase inhibitors. That is not to say there will be no interactions. With Islatravir, of course, is a very interesting drug and one that will have, again, very few because it's a nucleoside, and generally nucleoside analogs do not have many interactions at all. So I would imagine Islatravir, and if we're giving it by, looking at Islatravir in the future, it's going to be something that's going to be long acting, probably more than just giving it the once a week oral, which is another potential way the drug is going to be used. But giving the drug by a long acting method, very few interactions because you're not having the absorption issue, which some drugs we have interactions, the drug being absorbed and getting to the liver first. This is just going to be taken into the systemic circulation. So, Antonio, it's good news as far as drug interactions. It may be putting us out of a job. We may not need to be discussing drug interactions very much in the future. It doesn't mean there aren't any, but it does mean that we've got a much simpler overall view of these drugs. But we'll be at a... Fostemsavir will be in our database, hopefully by the middle of May, so in about 5 or 6 weeks. We'll also be having cabotegravir, rilpivirine, long-acting. I think that's ready to be launched next week indeed. In the HIV site, it should be in next week.
Okay, thank you very much. We have a question from Violeta.
Thank you. You have an excellent talk, Doctor. And I want to ask about that we have a patient that have a Fowler. We have the problem with Tegravir that we don't have this medication only with Tegravir. We only have with Tegravir, entricitabine, and TAF. And if I want to have a second line with this antiretroviral, and I can use Covicistat, Darunavir, Covicistat, Prescovid. We have a problem with the administration with TAF, or we have to use it, or we have to limit the dose for TAF for 10 milligrams, or what do you think about it?
Yeah, so the TAF issue is very interesting because there's a difference of opinion between the FDA and the European license, because clearly in the USA there's only 25 milligrams TAF, whereas in Europe we have both 10 and 25, so there is a difference. My own view is TAF is safe, and if you were in the US you wouldn't do anything about even thinking about the change of the dose. So I don't know, do you have experience of this already, or is this something that you're thinking about having to do?
Well, we have a patient that we use the first line of antiretroviral, for example, a Atripla, and they're Fowler. And then we have to change to the second line. And we think that, I think that Bictegravir can be a good antiretroviral switch, but I don't know. We have to use Prescovid, for example. But in Mexico, we only have the presentation of that in Bictegravir with 25 milligrams. Yep. They are using now they're introducing Discover to 10 milligrams and 25 milligrams of that. But if I want to use Bictegravir, not all the composition of Bictegravir, I only want the integrase inhibition of Bictegravir, but in Mexico and in all the world, only we have this protestation in with entricitabine and TAF with 25 milligrams.
Yeah.
And I don't know if we can use it safely with the use with the COVID-SYSTAT, with press COVID, darunavir COVID-SYSTAT, and that we don't have any problem for the more doses of TAF, that 25 milligrams.
No, I understand the problem. Ideally, given that there is this difference of opinion, I think you would get a different answer if you asked different experts about that actual issue. My own view is that TAF is, from everything that we've seen in clinical trials, is much safer. What are you worried about? You're worried about tenofovir exposure from TAF. Well, tenofovir exposure is so much less from TAF anyway than TDF. The only other point to consider is you're getting much higher concentrations of the active triphosphate from TAF than you are from TDF. But we don't think there's any toxicity related to that. So my own view is that ideally use 10 milligrams, but I wouldn't be over concerned about using 25. So using TAF FTC.
Thank you very much. That's all for me.
Thank you very much.
There is a rapid question from Oaxaca. Is there interactions between iron and integrase inhibitors?
Yeah, so in sense, iron does also, because it's a cation, you have the Fe2+, which means that's the chemistry. So it is a cation. And normally, if you look specifically at iron interactions, it depends how the iron is being given. What we're really concerned about is the absorption process of making sure we get the integrase inhibitor in. So if it's an iron injection, I'm not concerned about that. If it's an iron taken orally, then it's make sure we separate out again, just to be sure that the integrase inhibitor is being absorbed.
Okay, this is important in pregnant women.
Yeah, yes.
Thank you very much. Dr. Mata?
Hi, thank you, David. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. I think the question was answered partially because my question was regarding that in the European conference was presenting a study that combined Biktarvy plus darunavir COVID-SYSTAT or ritonavir, but regarding the TAF dose of 25 milligrams and the recommended dose in these cases is 10 milligrams. I don't know what kind of risk we could expect, what kind of problem we could expect with this kind of combination.
Yeah, I mean, I think it really does go back to the issue of why have the regulators come to a different view on, you know, only having a 25 milligram TAF in some part of the world, but having 10 and 25 in another part of the world. And I think it's because they believe that TAF is very much safer than the TDF, and we didn't need to have those two forms. I think it's caused a lot of confusion because we do have the 10 and the 25. The ideal, if you have COVID-SYSTAT with TAF, then 10 is absolutely enough because it will definitely be increased by the COVID-SYSTAT. But if you only have 25 and you want to give a darunavir COVID-SYSTAT, in my own view, that is not a problem. But you may get a different perspective from somebody else.
Thank you, David. Daniel, there is another question in the chat.
I can see it. I can see any more questions.
Is Marianne
Berraspe.
Okay. please?
No, she's asking if you think, Dr. Back, that is necessary the geriatrics attend people with HIV, that we are seeing the people is aging and the patients with a lot of interaction drugs, that if you think that the geriatrics have to involucre it in the treatment of the patient with HIV.
I'm very sorry, I didn't understand that question well. I don't know whether Antonio, did I? Sorry, I'm very sorry, I didn't really understand the question well.
Dr. David, if you consider necessary that a geriatrician could be involved in clinical practice of HIV patients regarding the polypharmacy that is increasing in this kind of age?
Yeah. So, I mean, it's certainly an issue. I mean, it's very important, I think, that we do reconciliation of meds and prescription reviews and just ensure that the drugs that a patient is on are all relevant to that patient's needs and requirements. And are there better, sometimes, as we all know, a patient can just stay on a regimen, a co-medication, and is it always necessary that medication is there? And it really depends on the hospital system and the medical system and the interaction between different specialties that sometimes this can become so complicated. And I'm sure you have stories in your own hospital about how patients might have medications which are unknown to the HIV providers. So this can become complicated. I don't know whether you have hospital pharmacists, but the role of pharmacists, where there are HIV specialist pharmacists, they can be very useful in making sure about some of the issues of drug interactions. Do you have that specialty?
No.
No.
We don't have it.
No. Well,
it's a problem.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And some is other question. The adjusted dose of metformin of 1,000 milligrams is equivalent to the normal dose?
Yeah, so I mean, the dose, the maximum dose often is going to be 1,000 milligrams BID, but this is the recommendation with having an integrase inhibitor is 500 milligrams BD or 1,000 milligrams a day. That is the recommendation simply because of that increase in exposure, which may be more in some patients than others. So again, not everyone may follow that, but that is the recommendation that you find in most guidelines and certainly in our database.
Okay, thank you very much. We have another question. I think no. Dr. Antonio Mata, another question?
No. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Back. It's a pleasure to hear you.
Thank you so much. I appreciate everyone being involved, and thank you so much for allowing me to come into your clinic.
Thank you very much,
Dr.
Thank you. Goodbye.